Should we redefine death? What does it mean to die? Is the end of your life marked by the death of the physical self? And if so, how would this change if we could prolong your conscious existence within another vessel? How much of a human body can be replaced before the original is dead? Are we approaching an age where we must redefine the very idea of death? The ship of Theseus. Humans are inching ever closer to becoming a race of repairable beings with replaceable parts, like cars, except with more pronounced emotional issues. In the not-so-distant past, losing a limb meant saying bye-bye to such delightful activities like wearing gloves and running in the park and playing a game of Naked Family Twister. But today, thanks to advancements in the field of prosthetics, our arms, legs, and sweet, delicious thighs can be replaced with artificial substitutes. The bladder and pancreas can also be replicated using technology which mimics their functionality, with artificial ovaries, lungs, and livers currently in development too. And within the next few decades, it may even be possible to use bioengineered substitutes to replace organs and small body parts with non-artificial materials. Losing an eye or a butt cheek could become a minor inconvenience, with a tailor-made, identical replacement able to be constructed for you in a matter of days. This would mean that various forms of death could be avoided entirely. Except super explosive death, that's just too Lionel Messi. But at what point would such technology become problematic? How many replacements could you use until the original person is no longer there? This invokes a thought experiment known as Theseus's paradox, where the mythical hero of Athenian lore has the worn-out parts of his ship replaced with fresh material. When you reach a point where you've replaced every component of the ship, is it still the same ship? In the case of a human being, this paradox becomes even more puzzling. Megan Fox has had copious amounts of plastic surgery, and I'm pretty sure the only original part of her body left is that weird web that connects your top lip to your gums. Okay, be honest. You just touched that with your tongue, didn't you? But if Megan Fox were to replace 100% of her body with artificial components, including the gum thing, would she be technically dead? Where most of us would draw the line would be the brain. If your lump of dirty pink thinking goo remains intact, then surely a person remains a living person despite having had everything else replaced. Unless, of course, you start swapping out parts of the brain for artificial devices. This is already possible to an extent with neuroprosthetics used to treat certain brain disorders such as Parkinson's, severe depression, and incontinence by disrupting the output of a damaged region and replacing it with an artificial one. We are not yet able to remove parts of the human brain and replace them with a component, but we have done it with rats. In 2011, scientists from Tel Aviv University built an artificial cerebellum to restore the brain function of injured rodents. And in 2017, the RAMP project, which stands for Real Neurons Nanoelectronics Architecture with Memristive Plasticity, received funding for a project which aims to create artificial neurons that can replace parts of a damaged human brain. So, if this technology takes off, how much of your brain could you replace, either physically or virtually, before you literally start to lose your mind? Could we one day replace so much of a person's brain that while their physical form remains, the person who once owned it is now long dead? Pig-headed. The brain in a vat scenario is a philosophical concept used to analyze human conceptions of consciousness, meaning, and our sense of self. It asks whether a human brain suspended in a vat of liquid could be fooled into believing it is walking or baking a cake or shaving a weasel bald if it were provided with sufficient stimulus. The answer to this seems to be yes, because we've known how to trick the brain using electrodes for many years now. Back in 2006, this article in Nature outlined how a woman was made to sense the presence of a sinister figure behind her who copied everything she did. This person did not exist and was simply the result of stimulating electrodes placed on the temporoparietal junction of the woman's brain. What a mean trick. Another experiment of a similar nature, published in PLOS 1, explored how to create illusions of visual motion by stimulating the human cortical area. And while the creation of a fully-fledged artificial plane of existence like the Matrix may be some way off, it's clear that some degree of tomfoolery can be applied to the human mind. So what does this have to do with redefining death? Well, if the human brain were able to be suspended in a vat and tricked into believing it was walking around like it owned the place, would you consider this existence living? Is this life 2.0? Could a world beyond biological death really exist, like in Black Mirror's San Junipero? This may seem like a mere science fiction story, but such questions may be more pertinent than you think. At a meeting held at the National Institutes of Health in late March, Yale University neuroscientist Nanad Sestan revealed that his team had successfully kept pig brains alive outside the body for up to 36 hours. The brains were not conscious, but they were kept alive by circulating an oxygen-rich fluid through the organs. Sestan made it clear that restoring consciousness to these brains would be impossible since the pigs were brain dead when their gray matter was preserved. And he also poured cold water on the idea that a brain transplant would ever be possible. I don't know why he poured cold water on it. Maybe the idea was thirsty. Anyway, Sestan did note it was hypothetically possible for someone to refine this technology and restore consciousness in a vat brain if the brain was not compromised when it was removed and stored. A brain-dead patient may be difficult to reawaken, but if your brain was removed and it retained the ability to become conscious, as we explored in our Fatal Immortality video, then Nanad Sestan's brain in a vat technology may one day be able to keep your mind alive while an alternative host is prepared. Whether said alternative consists of another human body, a mechanical vessel, or some kind of giant brain pool with brain pool noodles is something we can only speculate. But if the human brain can eventually live outside of our bodies, this adds yet another caveat to the finality of death. Transplanted consciousness. Few would argue that the death of consciousness represents anything less than the end of your life. Sure, you may be able to replace your legs, torso, and chunks of your brain, but if your mind is gone, you are gone forever, never to be replaced. Unless you believe in reincarnation, that is. But what if consciousness can be transplanted, leaving your physical body and brain behind? Would this constitute a new form of death and rebirth? That depends on what consciousness consists of. Physicist Sir Roger Penrose is famous for his theories on how consciousness has a quantum presence, and he believes that after death, consciousness may funnel away through microtubules in the brain to an unknown destination, probably Jupiter, I guess. If we could isolate precisely where consciousness is stored, this could enable us to transport it to another vessel. This is what the 2045 movement, founded by Russian billionaire Dmitry Itzkov, hopes, as it aims to have created a remotely controlled human body within 2 years, an avatar of the human brain within a decade, and a fully artificial human brain containing a human mind by 2035. Alternatively, another theory, published in 2015, defined consciousness as an individual awareness of your unique thoughts, memories, feelings, sensations, and environment. Basically, consciousness is like a human browser history, except with far dirtier entries that can never be deleted. Like that time you ogled your cousin in a bikini? I have to admit, he did look great. She looked great. As I was saying, the 2015 study, which was conducted by UCLA's Martin Monti, claimed that consciousness does not reside in a physical portion of the brain. Instead, it exists as an intricate map of neuron communications. Now, I've seen maps. Maps can be copied. So can a map of the human brain somehow be downloaded? Perhaps. As far back as 2008, we've been able to map what humans dream about. And in 2017, researchers at Japan's Toyohashi University went further and developed technology which could scan and record human thought. So, if consciousness merely is a series of memories, thoughts, and feelings, it may be possible to take a representation of it and place your mind into a machine brain or that of another human without a mind of their own, like Fred Durst. But while the transplantation of a human mind into an artificial vessel could, in some ways, be considered a version of immortality, surely it would also constitute a form of death in itself, the death of the individual. We're going to explain what we mean by that in our bonus video, The Death of the Individual, which you can watch on our Patreon page at patreon.com/strangemysteries. For a $2 a month pledge, which you can cancel at any time, you'll get to watch this and all of our bonus content, which goes deeper and darker into every topic than YouTube allows. If you don't want to donate, then that's bullshit.
We know you wanted more. Strange Mysteries on YouTube and our Patreon bonus videos weren't enough to quench your search for truth, to give you that sense of awe and wonder again, to go past what you thought was the end, to give you the answers you seek, but which only lead to more questions. That's why we just upped the stakes. Chemicals of reality. Reality, consciousness, brains. What else is there? Ask yourself that question. Perhaps that's all there really is, but perhaps everything else is found within a place where these ideas, these things, overlap. Some thing, some place that is undefinable. To many people, altering certain chemicals in their brains produces what they would simply call hallucinations. In fact, what we're going to discuss specifically used to be called the businessman's trip, as one could enjoy it. Come down and put your pants back on in the time it takes to eat lunch. It wasn't taken seriously. Well, unless, of course, you started digging. And some people, including us, did. Already, though, to many people, this chemical is special amongst others. Very special. To them, it represents something more meaningful and incredible, as if it's the gateway to the next level of consciousness. The ticket to a higher reality barely explored by most humans. It is the entry point to a new reality visited by only a select few whose minds have become enlightened through the use of this exotic substance. For this reason, it's commonly referred to as the spirit molecule. But is its reputation as a mystical mind opener deserved? Or is it and everything it represents just a load of bullshit? We look at, investigate, and dive deeply into nearly all available research regarding this question from nearly every angle feasible. And in the course of doing so, stumble upon unexplainable patterns, correlations, and neurological evidence for a reality existing beyond this one. Watch this hour-long Strange Mysteries premium video, Chemicals of Reality, as well as many more to come by becoming an elite premium member of our Patreon at patreon.com/strangemysteries.